Very good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is wellbeing, economy, fair work and energy. I would invite members wishing to ask a supplementary, as ever, to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant questions. I would also ask for brevity in questions as well as in responses. With that, we'll call question number one, Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made on the Energy Skills Passport for offshore energy workers.
Minister Lorna Slater.
The Energy Skills Passport project, for which we have committed nearly £5 million from the Just Transition Fund, reached a key milestone at the end of 2022 in the development of a prototype which will be tested with workers and employees in the next phase. I am pleased that trade unions have been engaging their workforce in the design of the passport solution, and unions are representing workers directly as part of the project review group for the passport. The Scottish Government supports delivery of a skills passport that will work for the different offshore energy industry sectors, recognising the cross-sector skills of workers and supporting a fair and managed transition. The offshore industries, including wind, have also demonstrated clear support for a solution that works for all and promotes a fairer transition in offshore energy.
Mercedes Villalba.
I thank the Minister for that response. As you'll know, the Energy Skills Passport was due to launch in the first quarter of this year, and we're now in May. Now, the unexplained delays are reportedly due to opposition from GWO, the Offshore Wind Standards Body. And in the meantime, offshore workers are continuing to face barriers to transition. So will the Minister use her role and her position to intervene and chair a crisis summit which includes APITO, GWO and the offshore trade unions, the RMT and Unite, to resolve this crisis, to end the delay and to give offshore energy workers the certainty that they need to transition?
Minister.
I support the member's call for the offshore skills passport to be delivered in a timely fashion, because of course we all want to support workers in a just transition. There is excellent progress being made on this project. As I said in my first answer, the proof of concept and prototype of the skills passport was completed and signed off by union reps in December. We're in the progress of a mapping exercise, so the mapping and alignment of standards, which is that big piece of bringing together the standards from multiple offshore sectors into one place. And we're looking at currently the mapped equivalent of about 75% of the core crew for an offshore installation, so that work is progressing well. And the project is moving into preparations for beta testing of that prototype with the intention to deliver the skills passport to end users in Q3 of this year.
A couple of brief supplementaries. First, Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. Offshore wind was mentioned there as a possible transition route for offshore energy workers. Now, 10 years ago, the government promised to deliver 28,000 jobs in offshore wind. By 2021, it had delivered just over 3,000. So what action has the government taken to examine the reasons it has failed so badly and ensure that the promise of 28,000 can be delivered?
Minister.
Obviously, we're all very keen for the offshore energy sector to have a just transition away from oil and gas to renewable energy, of which Scotland has so much potential. The creation of the offshore skills passport is a key part of this process because it removes those barriers for workers to make that transfer process between the sectors more simple and efficient, to allow that just transition, because it reduces the time and cost required for training. It also has the added benefit that the passport tool in use will be giving good visibility of potential career pathways and training needs for desired roles in that sector to help businesses plan their workforce and help the workforce plan for the roles that they want.
Ambitious Wishart.
Renewables are an important and growing sector, but there's still some feeling of uncertainty for workers with the desired skills because equivalent certification can be expensive. What support's available to offshore workers looking to transfer their skills?
As briefly as possible, Minister.
As I've just outlined, remember, this is the whole purpose of the Offshore Skills Passport, because it means that the different sectors of offshore have agreed to align their standards, and the passport will show which standards the worker can adhere to allow them to transition and move back and forth between different offshore energy sectors. That's exactly the purpose of the passport.
Question two has been withdrawn. Question three, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking in response to the recommendations of the independent review into women and entrepreneurship in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. First of all, we welcome the recommendations of Pathways, Anna Stewart and Mark Logan's review on supporting women in entrepreneurship. The challenge is clear. There remains an unacceptable gap in participation in entrepreneurship. The report offers a clear path to closing that gap and in supporting women to achieve their business ambitions, opening up economic opportunities for women and contribute to building a fairer, more prosperous wellbeing economy for Scotland. We are assessing and prioritising that report's proposals and preparing our response, which I would hope to publish in due course.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. The Pathway report was published in February and identified 31 ways to dramatically increase female participation. The First Minister at the time did say the government respond quickly to these recommendations. Yet when the First Minister spoke about his government priorities, he didn't mention the review at all. So while the Cabinet Secretary indicates we can expect a response soon, I would like to know when we can expect a response, when the recommendations will be taken forward, including the need for a women's business centre.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Claire Baker for that question and her work in the committee, but also on the cross-party group for women in enterprise as well. We have a huge economic opportunity before us if we can close not just the gender pay gap, the gender employment gap, but also the gender gap that exists in new enterprise being established in Scotland, which is pertinent to this question. Of course, we will respond to that report as quickly as we possibly can. We've also got the commitment to the Women Business Centre, Female Business Centre as well, and I'm very excited about the opportunity that we have before us if we can realise closing that gap and ensure we are giving people, women, the opportunity to get on in business.
Question 4, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to welcome the Minister to her new role. And I'd like to ask the Scottish Government what its latest engagement has been with the UK Government regarding financial pressures that households in Scotland are facing as a result of energy costs.
Minister Gillian Martin.
Thank Jim Fairley for that question. The disproportionate impact of high energy prices on fuel-poor households across Scotland is something that I'm raising as a matter of urgency with the UK Government. And while I'm disappointed that earlier requests from Scottish ministers to meet with the Secretary of State were not answered, I aim to meet with the Minister for Energy Consumers soon to seek action from them on issues including support for those that have been most affected by the Energy Bill Support Scheme ending and the introduction of a much-needed social tariff for energy consumers. Yeah.
Jim Fairley.
I'd thank the Minister for that answer. According to the OBR, the UK is expected to suffer the biggest fall in living standards since records began in 1950, with real household disposable income expected to fall by 5.7% over 22-23 and 23-24. Now, last week, I held an energy summit in Perth, where experts from Citizens Advice Bureau, Home Energy Scotland, SCARF and PKC shared information and solutions about how to save money on fuel bills and the cost of living pressures. So what else can the Scottish Government do to press the UK Government to relieve the pressures their economic mismanagement has introduced for far too many of my constituents?
Minister.
I thank Jim Fairley for that supplementary question, and I commend him for the work that he's doing to help his constituents. As I said, we've called repeatedly for action from the UK Government, including ahead of the spring budget review, but a real difference could have been made, but it failed to deliver. Yeah. In addition to the meeting that I hope to have with the UK Minister for Energy Consumers, I'm going to be progressing work delivered as a result of the Scottish Government Energy Summits last year, and I intend to give us and our partners in Scotland a stronger combined voice, which we will continue to use to challenge the UK Government on the need for more action to support most in need. Can I recommend that Mr Fairley, and indeed all MSPs, signpost any constituents that are having real difficulty in paying their bills to Advice Direct Scotland, who are administering the Scottish Government's home heating support and whose offices I visited yesterday. We've tripled our fuel insecurity fund, but as Mr Fairley alludes to, the core cost that's affecting families needs to be tackled by the UK Government, who have the powers to make a real difference in this area.
Okay, and a couple of supplementaries briefly first. Sarah Boyer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Has the Scottish Government discussed the issue of the potential of a UK windfall tax, given the unprecedented energy profits being made, and the Scottish Government's own plans for its energy company, which it was proposing to establish? Will that be on the agenda with the UK Minister? Because we need to accelerate plans to invest in energy-efficient homes in Scotland, to eradicate fuel poverty, lower bills, create jobs and deliver on net zero. Wouldn't that be a practical way to get going with it?
Minister.
Thanks, Sarah Boyett, for her question. There's lots of practical things that can be done a lot sooner than some of the things that she actually mentions from the UK government. But given that we only really in the Scottish Government have the powers with regards to helping people make their homes more energy efficient, that's where we're directing quite a lot of our powers and our funding indeed. We've built the commitment to double the fuel and security fund, as I've mentioned, and our winter heating payment replaces the DWP's cold weather payment, a reliable annual £550 payment that's helping around 400,000 low-income individuals with the heating expenses. Quite a lot of the things you mentioned in relation to energy companies, a lot of the powers that are required of that really do at the moment sit with the UK government. I have had a meeting last week with UK Minister Andrew Bowie about some of the issues, some of the very small constitutional issues that actually might be able to help us do a lot more in that area, which need to be devolved to this Parliament.
And briefly, Willie Rennie.
600,000 homes in Scotland are in extreme fuel poverty, but last year only just over 5,000 households were helped with insulation programme by the government. And this year's Warmer Homes scheme won't even open again until October. So why is the SNP Green government so slow in insulating people's homes?
Minister.
Well, our National Fuel Poverty Scheme, Warmer Homes Scotland, is designed to help those living in at risk of fuel poverty. But unfortunately, in the last year or so, a lot of people who were not in fuel poverty have been plunged into fuel poverty, not because of the actions of the Scottish Government, because of the increase in fuel costs and the increase of energy bills that people have had. Basically, you're ploughing in money to actually mitigate some of the crisis here. But if we had some real action in bringing down the cost of people's fuel in the first place, then we wouldn't be in this situation, frankly. Yeah.
Question 5, Michael Manor.
To ask the Scottish Government what impact it anticipates the reported closure of Tayside Aviation will have on the financial sustainability of Dundee Airport and the associated Tay Cities deal funding.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
Can I say at the outset that I'm very concerned to hear of the job losses at Tayside Aviation, and my thoughts are with the workers affected and their families. The Scottish Government remains committed to providing Highlands and Islands Airport Limited with sufficient support to maintain operations at all 11 of its airports, including Dundee. And Scottish Government officials will discuss implications on the Tay Cities region deal with both local partners and the UK Government.
Michael Manor.
Thank the Minister for that answer. That the closure of Tayside Aviation will not threaten the future of the airport is of vital importance to Dundee, and I thank him for that assurance. It will, of course, be of cold comfort to the 22 people who have lost their jobs. What can the Minister tell us, and what can he update Parliament on what they are doing to support the Aviation Academy for Scotland project, the Tay City Deals project? What actions has he taken? And most importantly, I think today, what assurances can they give to the people who have paid money as students who have lost the future that was in front of them, and have they had discussions with the RAF about the crucial contract that was in place or should have been in place with the Aviation Academy? Will he meet me to discuss these really important issues?
Minister.
Can I just say I'd be happy to meet the member to discuss these issues, and I'll certainly check out the point about the RAF. In terms of his further two more general questions, it's important to say that no Scottish Government funding, of course, went directly to Tayside Aviation in terms of supporting the students. University students should have, of course, also been contacted directly by their own universities, and Scottish Government officials have been engaging, particularly with Middlesex University and the University of Central Lancashire, who are delivery partners for the courses, to understand what contingencies are in place to support those students who are most affected. In terms of the wider project over the Aviation Academy, which is part of the local region deal, of course, that's a UK project of £8.1 million. So whilst this unfortunate business closure we're talking about in Parliament today will certainly impact on the future development of that project, we want to continue to work with the regional partners to explore alternative viable delivery options. But as he also, as a member, confirmed in his own remarks, that we are confirming the funding will not be lost to the region. And we'll, in terms of the airport, we'll continue to do what we can to support it.
And supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I raised the First Minister's questions last week, the issue Michael Mara referred to about students, many of whom have paid large sums up front in fees in relation to degree courses being partly delivered by Tayside Aviation. There's a huge issue for them in terms of the financial issue, but the other issue is how do they complete their degree courses without that provision of training local to their home base in Scotland? Does the Minister have any suggestions as to what alternative provision might be made available to students who are caught in that situation.
Minister.
I recognise the member's interest in this issue, and as indicated in my previous answer, officials are in contact with the relevant universities to look at what alternative plans were put in place and to discuss the wider implications of what's happened. So I think the best thing for me to do is to speak to my colleagues and drop a note to those local members who have an interest in this issue and the implications for the students, and we'll give you an update as soon as we can.
Question number six, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its interim goals of reaching 50% of disabled people in employment by 2023 and 60% in employment by 2030.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. The latest available ONS annual population survey data indicates the employment rate for disabled people in Scotland had increased to 50.7% in January to December 2022 from 49.6% the previous year. This means we have achieved our first interim target of 50% of disabled people being in employment at 1 year early. We are currently on track to achieve the subsequent target of 60% by 2030, and the refreshed Fair Work Action Plan published last December sets out the further actions we will take to meet our aim to halve the disability employment gap by 2038.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the Minister for that answer. And ACS Clothing in my constituency have recognised how standard interview processes very often exclude disabled people from securing jobs right at the outset. And their inclusive approach has helped earn them the Disability Confident Leader accreditation. Can the Minister share what further actions the Scottish Government will take to support an increase in the number of employers practising inclusive and accessible interview processes with a view to more local employers recognising and benefiting from the talents disabled people bring to our workplaces?
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, I want to thank Stephanie Callaghan for her question and for the work that she does through the cross-party groups on autism and learning disabilities to support disabled people's lives being made better. I'd also like to congratulate ACS on the work they are doing to create an environment in which disabled people can partake in and benefit from inclusive and accessible interviews. The Scottish Government believes a culture change is required for employers to have the competency and confidence to offer appropriate support to disabled people to access work. To date, we have invested close to £1 million into a public social partnership, which is working to improve the recruitment and retention rates for disabled people by developing and testing different types of support for employers. And ACS were supported through this partnership to attain the accreditation that Stephanie Callaghan referred to. Last year, we commissioned a disabled people's organisation to deliver a programme of training and development around disability inclusion and equally on a test and learn basis in two Fair Start Scotland contract areas. And this programme includes development of accessible interviews.
And supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, are there plans to produce a refreshed employment action plan for the disability employment gap to reduce that addresses the challenges of a post-COVID labour market?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm certainly happy to look at that. I think we have to recognise the impact that COVID has had on disabled people entering the employment market. I'd be happy to consider that. And also happy to work with Jeremy Balfour and others to ensure that the UK Government is living up to its responsibilities there too. I'm old enough to remember when the UK Government had a target to halve the disability employment gap. Sadly, that is no longer the case.
Question 7 has been withdrawn. Question 8, Ben McPherson.
To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting the regeneration and development of Grantham Waterfront.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. The Scottish Government is represented on the Grantham Waterfront Strategic Partnership, which enables regular engagement with the City of Edinburgh Council and partners on the development and delivery of their plans for the regeneration of the Grantham Waterfront area. Through the partnership, we're able to discuss ways in which collaborative cross-portfolio support can be provided in the ongoing development and delivery of the place based vision for Grantham. This has included investment of over £9 million in the early phases of the development to help unlock sites and support development of the Western Villages demonstrator project.
Ben McPherson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer and for the funding committed and engagement so far from the Scottish Government. The regeneration of Grantham Waterfront has remarkable further potential to deliver on multiple wellbeing economy and social justice policy objectives. Therefore, in supplementary to what the Minister has already said, can the Scottish Government consider how it could further support this nationally significant development project in a holistic way, including how a process might work to allow a multi-year package of government funding to be secured to meet those multiple policy objectives and deliver new housing, facilities and opportunities for the benefit of North Edinburgh visitors and our capital city as a whole?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I thank Ben McPherson for his diligence as the local MSP for Edinburgh Northern and Leith in bringing this really important issue to the Chamber. And of course, the Scottish Government is working with the Grant and Waterfront Strategic Partnership, which is providing support from the range of portfolios involved in delivering this place-based approach to the regeneration of Granton. It includes support and advice on the completion of robust business plans by the partnership to identify the funding going forward that will be required from a range of sources, including private investment. And I would, of course, be more than happy to meet with Ben McPherson to discuss these and any further ideas that he may have.
And supplementary, Miles.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will agree with me that the UK Government's levelling up funding of over £16 million to restore and reopen the B-listed Granton Gas holder is a welcome investment and can really act as a catalyst to support the regeneration and redevelopment of Granton and the whole city waterfront. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what work he is doing to help with the next set of levelling up funding projects to make sure that every part of Scotland, especially Edinburgh's waterfront, really realises that potential?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Miles Briggs for that question. Of course, I welcome that funding. Miles Briggs would expect me, of course, to challenge the fact that the Levelling Up Fund has not been as targeted as I think it could be, nor has met the levels of expenditure that match the predecessor funding that came forward through our membership of the European Union. So, of course, I'll be looking to meet with the UK Government in order to look at the next phase of the Levelling Up Fund, to challenge them to go further, to make sure that the investments meet with devolved priorities, and to ensure that we are no longer cut out of that decision-making process.
Thank you, and that concludes portfolio questions on wellbeing, economy, fair work and energy. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next portfolio to allow front bench members to change. And the next portfolio is finance and parliamentary business. Again, I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. Again, usual appeal for brevity in questions and responses. And I call question number one, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much it is allocated from its budget to cover the cost of its challenge of the decision of the UK Secretary of State for Scotland to issue an order under Section 35 of the Scotland Act 1998 in respect of the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks. We consider that challenging the UK Government's use of Section 35 is the only option for a government that wants to uphold and defend the democratic will and devolved powers of this Parliament. At this stage, it would be entirely speculative to comment on what the costs of the challenge would be or who would meet them. Any costs incurred by the Scottish Government will be published in due course.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Most of the Scottish public remains opposed to the GRR Bill. The wider gender self-ID policy also contributed to the downfall of Nicola Sturgeon when she housed a male double rapist in a women's prison. This is a deeply flawed policy whereby many Scots supported the UK Government blockage of the bill itself. And it does appear that the sole reason the SNP government seemed to be sticking with it is to pick a fight with the UK government alongside keeping the extremist Green Party happy. But, Cabinet Secretary, is it truly worth wasting hundreds of thousands of pounds of taxpayers' money on something that is likely to be defeated in the courts and that most Scots, including one quarter of SNP voters, oppose?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, let me first of all remind Annie Wells that the bill was passed by an overwhelming majority of the Scottish Parliament with support from members of all parties. And, of course, the use of Section 35 is an unprecedented challenge to the Scottish Parliament's ability to legislate on devolved matters and risks setting a dangerous constitutional precedent by allowing a veto on this Parliament's democratic decisions. It's absolutely important to have clarity on the interpretation and scope of the UK Government's Section 35 power.
and its impact on devolution in these matters and the use of the powers should be legally tested in the courts. In terms of taxpayers' money, it is a bit ironic in the week where the head of the UK's Debt Management Office said that the mini-budget had cost the UK an eye-watering £74 billion, of which Scotland's share would be over £6 billion. And, of course, that was through a government supported and enabled by Annie Wells and her colleagues. So I won't take any lesson from Annie Wells or the Tories about the use of taxpayers' money in the eye of this eye-watering amount wasted by the UK government.
And supplementary, Colin Beattie.
Despite the UK government's claim to have concerns about the bill, it's my understanding that they have as yet refused to engage with the Scottish Government or the Scottish Parliament to attempt to resolve them. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that if the Conservatives have concerns about the costs of challenging the Section 35 order, they could start to address them by pressing their colleagues at Westminster to actually engage with the Scottish Government on the bill rather than undemocratically attempting to block it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, that's, of course, correct. After the Secretary of State for Scotland made the Section 35 order, I met with him and proposed that our governments work together to clarify and seek to address any specific concerns. He refused any further engagement and offered only three options: drop the bill, address his concerns in an amended bill, but with no indication of which areas they would want amended, or we could pursue legal action. So the legal challenge is not what we wanted to happen with this bill after it was passed, as I said earlier, by an overwhelming majority of this Parliament, but we have been left with absolutely no choice in the matter. And of course, the UK government could avoid these legal costs by revoking the Section 35 order, and we would then gladly resume dialogue with them on this issue.
Question 2, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government what financial assessment has been made of any impact on the capital budget of delays in delivering infrastructure projects.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government continuously reviews the impact that factors such as project delays, inflationary pressures and market conditions have on our capital programme to ensure Scotland's money is being spent in the right places. This is done through the annual budget process and periodically with our six-monthly reporting on the infrastructure investment plan. The Scottish Budget 23-24 set out over £6.3 billion of capital spending to support employment and the economy through our large-scale infrastructure plans to move us along the path to net zero carbon emissions and to underpin the provision of quality public services.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response? We know that the cost of infrastructure projects has risen, partly due to inflation, partly due to the availability of materials, partly due to not having enough construction workers. This will lead to cost overruns and delays. We're already seeing that with the national treatment centres and projects like the replacement St Brendan's Hospital in Barra, promised by Nicola Sturgeon in 2007 and now completely cancelled. So will the Cabinet Secretary commit to publishing a list of all capital projects with revised costs and timelines before the start of summer recess?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, Jackie Bailey is quite right to point to all of the pressures that are coming and impacting on capital budgets, the inflation. She mentioned the costs, the labour costs, the cost of materials. All of that is absolutely the case. And in addition to that, of course, we have the combined effects of COVID, of Brexit, and the war in Ukraine. We also have the flat and falling capital grant allocation that Scotland has received from the UK government, all putting pressure on our capital programme. What we will do is to continue to work through the capital projects, many of which are at different stages, Jackie Bailey will understand. Many are well advanced. Some are at the early start. Any major changes to the capital programme, of course, we will inform Parliament about those changes.
And a number of hopefully brief supplementaries. First, John Mason.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary mentioned inflation, and I wonder if she can say anything more about that, because it does seem that the UK with 10.1% inflation is higher than Italy 8.3, Germany 7.2, France 5.9. What is different about the UK?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, John Mason makes an important point here, and I think one of the key differences is the The issue of Brexit, which has exacerbated all of these global factors, and of course the economic policies of the UK government, the mini budget that I referred to earlier on, which of course is costing the UK £74 billion. So these are issues that are, of course are going to impact on our budgets. Building materials were increasingly hard to source last year. Price inflation in the sector peaked at around 25% last summer. All of these issues are going to impact on our capital budget. What we will do is to make sure through the difficult choices that inevitably we'll have to make, that we prioritise our capital budget to the clear priorities that have been set out by this government, and the prospectus that was launched by the First Minister reiterates what those priorities are.
And for the supplementary, Liz Smith.
Can I ask, in relation to Jackie Bailey's question, if the Cabinet Secretary is aware of some of the concerns that have been raised at the Finance Committee recently by former ministers and former civil servants, that sometimes when it comes to financial decision-making, some of the financial rules have been seen as, I quote, optional. Could I ask that when she's looking at infrastructure projects, that that matter is addressed as well, so that we know clearly what the rules are supposed to be?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, I look forward to giving evidence on some of these matters, along with the Permanent Secretary, around decision-making, both for ministers and indeed in terms of the advice given by the civil service. I don't recognise some of the characterisation within Liz Smith's comments. I think in my experience as a minister for probably on more than 15 years now, the decision-making is very robust, not least that the advice that we commission and receive is based on the best advice available to ministers. Does that mean that that decisions are always correct in the light of things that then occur? Of course, any government will face issues where decisions are made on the basis of the best available advice at the time, but then changing some circumstances thereafter. But I look forward to getting into more of the detail of this at the committee session.
And briefly, Willie Rennie.
A lack of transparent decision-making, a lack of project oversight, and no clear understanding of what significant sums of public money have achieved. The Auditor-General last year talking about the late ferries. This year, the government has admitted that the bosses have been paid big bonuses that the government had no clue about, and a crew has been paid £1.6 million for ferries that can't sail. Has the government learned a single thing in the last year?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, we have, and ministers have, of course, apologised for the delay to the ferries and the distress and difficulties it caused. The delivery of six new major vessels to serve Scotland's ferry network by 2026 is, of course, a key priority for this government. The issue of bonuses has been gone over in fine detail, and, of course, I wrote to the NZ committee around the latest issue, which, of course, the new chair of Ferguson's has been very clear in terms of the remuneration packages going forward, that bonuses will not feature within those packages, but those legacy bonuses, unfortunately, due to contractual issues, could not be avoided. The issue of the payment of crew for non-sailing vessels, I'm happy to write to Willie Rennie with more detail of that, but of course Transport Scotland continue to work closely with CalMac, CMAL and Ferguson's to align the recruitment of crew with vessel deployment plans. But if he wants more information on that, I can make sure that either I write to him or the appropriate minister does.
Thank you. Question 3, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how much is allocated from its budget to cover any additional costs resulting from the delay in the deposit return scheme.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you. Scotland's Deposit Return Scheme is an industry-led scheme and in line with the principles of producer responsibility. The investments made by business to date will be important for the success of the scheme when it launches on the 1st of March 2024. Accordingly, the Scottish Government has not allocated additional funding to cover industry costs of a delay. A wide range of business have welcomed the delay of Scotland's DRS, and we, SEPA, Circularity Scotland, are now working intensely so that we are able to launch, to be ready for a launch in March next year. However, this will only be achievable if the UK Government urgently issues an exclusion for the scheme from the Internal Market Act, giving business the certainty that they deserve and need.
Megan Gallagher.
A concerning answer from the Minister. The Federation of Independent Retailers have called on the SNP to compensate retailers who have already signed contracts for the reverse vending machines due to the recently announced delay. What is the Government doing to financially support those who have entered into expensive contracts for RVMs, who now may not need to provide RVMs as a result of the changes to the details of the scheme?
Minister.
The contracts that the member is relating to, the member will be aware, are a matter for the contract between Circularity Scotland and the producers. So the members can be assured that not only the largest producers are making those contributions. In terms of retailers, obviously retailers are now able to register, and smaller retailers in particular are able to exempt. To apply for an exemption. However, many retailers are really keen to be part of the scheme, and because it will attract footfall to their schemes. So if the member is concerned about delay and further delay, I would really urge her to urge her colleagues at Westminster to make sure the exclusion we need in order to get the scheme up and running is in place as quickly as possible.
Supplementary, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A multinational company with a dubious environmental record is the sole logistics partner for the deposit return scheme, something that should raise concern about the potential to distort competition in the waste management sector. The final business regulatory impact assessment, released in late 2021, doesn't look at this, but we would expect a new assessment to be released whenever the regulations are amended. So, will the new assessment examine the logistics contract, and if not, will the Minister ask the Competition and Markets Authority to do so?
Minister.
So I think that's a matter which would be better if the Minister responsible for the scheme contacted the member, so I'll make sure she's aware of your question.
Thank you. Question 4 is not lodged. Question 5, Richard Leonard.
Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to support responsible and ethical tax collection policies.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The Scottish Government recognises the importance of ensuring responsible and ethical tax collection practices are in place and the role of the tax collection agencies in this regard. Robust governance arrangements are in place with HMRC and Revenue Scotland, who both have a statutory function to protect revenue against fraud and tax avoidance. Local authorities are responsible for the collection of council tax and non-domestic rates. The Scottish Government have empowered them to tackle avoidance loopholes, encourage them to share good practice on debt assistance and collection too. Thank you.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Minister for that reply? The Fair Work Agreement between Scottish ministers and civil service trade unions states in paragraph 28, I quote, "Scottish ministers are committed to publicly run, publicly delivered public services and are committed against the outsourcing of public services. The outsourcing of tax collection is a test of that commitment. Last year, a new contract was signed by HMRC with private debt collection agencies. So will the Scottish Government, which has a service level agreement with HMRC, rule out the deployment of private debt collection agencies for the collection of Scottish income tax? Will you write into that agreement that income tax compliance in Scotland will be undertaken only by workers in the public sector? And does the Minister accept that this is a question of moral responsibility and ethical standards and not simply an operational matter?
Minister.
Now, thank Mr. Leonard for his supplementary. He raises very significant points, and I know he does it from a place of a genuine moral and ethical concern. As you will appreciate, HMRC operates UK-wide, and with regard to its debt collection practices within Scotland, it will not just be partaking in debt collection practices relating to the devolved aspects of Scottish income tax, but also, for example, reserve taxes. One of those reserve taxes is, of course, national insurance, which could be potentially interlinked with regards to debt pertaining to income tax. However, he does raise a lot of points. I'm going to take that away and consider what further action can be taken, but I would just reiterate the point to the member that HMRC operates on a UK-wide basis, But notwithstanding that, I will take these points away and I will be happy to update the member on correspondence in due course.
Question number six, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what impact assessment it has undertaken regarding any reductions to core funding allocations in its budget for third sector organisations.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government grant making is allocated across portfolios to various parts of the third sector to improve a wide range of outcomes. Some Scottish Government funding will be issued through third sector intermediary organisations. Any assessments on funding levels will have been taken by individual policy areas.
Thank you. I wrote to the former Cabinet Secretary for Finance over a month ago with regard to the future of Bridgend Farmhouse here in Edinburgh, who have received Scottish Government Investing in Communities funding for the last 4 years. On February the 15th, the organisation received notification that they would not continue to receive funding. This is a fantastic organisation, a host of over three social enterprises, and a really place where the community can come together. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that Bridgend Farmhouse no longer being able to operate would be a significant impact here in the south of the city? And would she agree to visit Bridgend Farmhouse and review this core cut to core funding?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, can I say to Miles Briggs, I will look at out that correspondence. It's not something I'm familiar with, but I will have a look for it. Clearly, these are difficult decisions. The grant funding to third sector organisations is always oversubscribed. The same for social enterprise funding, and therefore the prioritisation around that grant funding is done in a way to align with the clear priorities set out by the government in terms of reducing poverty, the net zero ambitions, sustainable public services. So it is not possible to fund every organisation that applies for funding. However, as I said at the beginning, I am happy to have a look at the correspondence about Bridgend Farmhouse, and I will write back myself to Miles Briggs once I've managed to do that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Question 7 is not lodged. Question 8 was withdrawn. So that concludes portfolio questions on finance and parliamentary business. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business.